When it rains, it pours. Inflation, supply chains, war, and tightening financial conditions. We've got it all. This is Bloomberg Wall Street Week. I'm David Westin. This week, special contributor Larry Summers on what it will take to get inflation back under control.
The real determinants of inflation have to do with the total level of demand that's being stimulated by policies.
And Roger Altman of Evercore on whether things really are as bad as they look and what can be done about it.
It certainly could get worse before it gets better.
It wasn't a great week on Global Wall Street. Consumer price numbers may have slowed down a bit, but according to Sarah House of Wells Fargo, not nearly enough.
You are seeing some deceleration there, but you're going to need to see a lot more.
The war in Ukraine continued as President Putin made it clear he's not about to stop anytime soon.
Это значит, что на самом деле
NATO countries didn't want to listen to us, and in fact, what happened? They had completely different plans.
While in China, doubts grow about the economic path forward.
It's less a story about China stimulating the global economy and more about whether or not it can even get its own economy on a base level.
And you can forget about crypto as a place to hide from the storm, as Terra's USD stablecoin lost its dollar peg.
In short, the entire model fell apart and was unable to withstand a black swan event or an adverse event.
And Secretary Yellen warned of the potential risks for the financial system overall.
I think that simply illustrates that this is a rapidly growing product and there are risks to financial stability.
And if all that weren't enough for you, we ended the week on Friday the 13th with Elon Musk tweeting that his bid for Twitter was on temporary hold, sending the stock down by as much as 25% at one point before he sent another tweet saying he was still committed to the deal, which helped a bit, but still left the stock off about 10%. And as for the markets overall, equities made a valiant effort on Friday to come back from a bad week, but the S&P 500 still finished down 2.4% for the week, closing lower for the sixth week in a row, while the NASDAQ was off 2.8%, and the yield on the 10-year came down 20 basis points, ending the week at 2.92. To help us make some sense out of this rather chaotic week, we welcome now Kate Moore. She's BlackRock Global Allocation Team Head of Thematic Strategy, and David Bianco, CIO for DWS America. So, David, it's not a very easy task, but what sense was made out of this week?
Oh, this week was volatile. At least it ended on a happy note. Happy Friday. Happy Friday the 13th. And we appreciate that equities ended the week on a strong note. But let's face it, the equity market and most asset classes have been under a lot of pressure year to date. The S&P, it's flirting with a bear market. It was down as much as 18-19% during the week. Now it's down 16% from its all-time highs.
Well, what about that bear market, Kate? Because some people, at least around Bloomberg, late on Friday were saying what we really saw was a bounce off of that level of bear market, sort of a bear market bounce, as it were.
Yeah, I mean, the way I think about today's trading, David, was more that the sellers took off early for the weekend rather than buyers having a huge amount of conviction. You know, I think sentiment is such an important thing to track right now. And we're seeing kind of all of the major segments of investors, whether it's retail or traditional mutual funds and long only and hedge funds, have a pretty dour outlook for both the market and the economy. And, you know, it's my view that we're not going to see a meaningful and sustained rally, something that takes us closer to, say, 4,500 on the S&P, until we can really firm sentiment and kind of allay some of the fears around the economy and inflation and policy mistakes and the war in Ukraine and Chinese growth. I mean, the list goes on. You laid that out at the beginning of the show.
Well, it does make sense to me what Kate's saying. I think we're in a range-bound market for some time. Markets just need to figure out what the normal interest rates are. And until we have an understanding as to where interest rates stabilize, and especially not until the bond markets stop suffering losses, the equity market's at risk. I think the S&P is in a trading range that is not much lower from where we were this week, but 5,000 is likely out of reach for the next year, maybe two.
So, Kate, when you look at the equity market in relation to the bond market, how much of this is discounting future earnings? Basically, it's a discount rate put against future earnings. And how much was actually the multiple?
Yeah, I mean, look, in the highest growth parts of the market, the stuff that was commanding ridiculous multiples for a lot of 2021, you know, that derating really started in November and has continued through the course of 2022. Look, I think it's fair to assume that rates are going to have to move higher. You know, even if the economy is slowing a bit, we still believe we're far away from a recession. And we think the Fed is in the very early stages of normalizing policy, both in terms of policy rates, as well as, of course, quantitative tightening and reducing, changing the size of the balance sheet. So, you know, those two things together are going to, I think, exert a bit of pressure and I think going to keep volatility high. We keep watching the relationship between, rates fall and equity vol and see if there's a change in the pattern. But right now, I think they're going to stay elevated.
That's exactly right. I mean, we're watching interest rates. We're watching interest rate volatility. It's just representative of how much uncertainty there is on where interest rates are likely to go up, but where do they plateau? And yes, higher interest rates, particularly higher real interest rates, is reducing the PE multiple. And then there's this uncertainty about how long this expansion might last. I've said that this expansion is 2 years old, but perhaps going on 7 or 9 years old biologically when it has a 10-year expected lifespan. So they've not only used a higher discount rate to take in the PE, they've also shortened their forecast horizons, and so they're not paying for future growth. Instead, they're valuing the more certain earnings and dividends that you see coming from certain companies now.
Yeah, and I have to say, you know, we look around and say there are a lot of high-quality companies that you want to own for the next 3 or 5 years that are trading at pretty attractive multiples right now. That said, could the multiples overshoot to the downside? I mean, I think the answer is yes. There's a high probability that as the uncertainty rises around the macro environment and policy, that you end up seeing multiples get to kind of really silly cheap levels. Mm. If you want to average in, then great, but this is a challenging environment.
I think it's still a good environment for the long-term investor. You have to find that person. That person needs to really understand the volatility they may be facing. The S&P is trading at 17.5 to 18 times this year's earnings. A 20 PE is still reasonable given these interest rates. They're still much lower than history. Now, the Fed has an inflation fight to fight, but it's unlikely that interest rates go anywhere near where they were historically.
So, Kate, we've really focused quickly on inflation, which is only appropriate given the CPI numbers we had this week, and the interest rates. But there are other risks out there as well. We have a war pending in Ukraine, for example, and there are possible effects on the supply chain that can affect certainly the cost to companies going forward and their margins.
Yeah, I think this is one of our big focuses right now. Look, you know, when you look back a couple years ago during the trade war and some of the changes in terms of tariffs, for example, you had a lot of companies come out and say, hey, we're going to rejigger our supply chain. We're going to rethink, you know, where we're producing relative to where we're selling. They said that. There wasn't a lot of follow through when it came to capital expenditure and investment in order to onshore or reshore some production. I think this experience of the last 2 years of the pandemic, and certainly the supply shocks that we've seen in part because of dependence on China, is going to incite like a new round of capital expenditure, actually a real one, in terms of supply chains. But that's expensive, David, and it's going to cost companies a large amount of money and take time. So we got to watch margins.
It's a challenging global economy. The partnerships that we've had in Asia and the challenges that Europe is now facing for their security, for their energy, and even a refugee crisis, there are many threats out there to the health of this expansion. And the pandemic and some of the monetary and fiscal responses to it have caused demand to cause a bit more inflation than any of us are comfortable with in the past 40 years. But I'm also taking more concern with secular challenges, structural challenges, facing the global economy, because things that drive productivity, trade, global investment, demographics, cooperation on a global scale, these are things that we're not seeing as much of that we saw in past decades, and we even have more resource constraints. So inflation should come down, but it may not come down as fast or as low as the Fed wants it to come down.
Kate, we certainly have a risk on interest rates, although I think we're pretty clear that they're going to go up. It's a question of how far they go up and how fast, not where they're going to go up. But if I had to make you choose between the biggest risk in terms of uncertainty and between, on the one hand, interest rates for an investor and the war in Ukraine and uncertainty of that, which would you pick?
Oh, David, that's a tough question. I don't think that interest rates are that uncertain. In fact, I give Jay Powell and the Fed broadly an A-plus in terms of how they've been communicating more recently. I think it's very, very, very clear to see that we'll continue to raise policy rates through the balance of this year, and that will be a steady progression. We'd have to have a massive shock, I think, in terms of, you know, an economic shock or an expansion of the conflict that's currently in Ukraine. I am worried about the shifting of political alliances. I am worried about what this does to overall energy relationships. I am worried about the feed through to European growth of this ongoing conflict in Ukraine, though.
Similar thoughts. We're more concerned about the war, the conflict in Europe. It speaks about the dare I say, deglobalization, that's just a lesser cooperation that's been in the world. Interest rates, the Fed is doing what they need to do. This looks like it will be a typical Fed hiking cycle of about 300 basis points and 3% of total Fed hikes over a 1.5 year period. A pretty normal Fed hiking cycle, even though inflation has jumped higher than we've seen it in so many decades. But the Fed may be facing challenges greater than normal owing to these global threats that we see out there.
Kate Moore of BlackRock and David Bianco of DWS Americas will be staying with us as we take a look down the road and what it means for investors if this inflation is here to stay. That's coming up next on Wall Street Week on Bloomberg.
We've got some inflation built into the system, and price rises aren't going to go away overnight. But I think we begin seeing some hopeful signs that we're at a point here where we can begin getting a grip on this situation.
That, of course, was Paul Volcker on Wall Street Week way back in 1975. That was when he was the president of the New York Fed before he got to administer his medicine to the economy as head of the Federal Reserve. David Bianco of DWS Americas and Kate Moore of BlackRock are still with us. So, Kate, let me ask you a question that I'm hearing more and more. Some people are suggesting this may be here for a long time to come. We had Jason Furman on from Harvard earlier this week on Bloomberg. He said he thinks it could be years we have really high inflation. If that's right, if that proves to be true, what does that say to investors?
Well, actually, you know, as much stress as we have around higher inflation rates, particularly since most of us haven't had to deal with this for the majority of our lives, there's actually a really interesting investment theme around higher inflation. It's really interesting to look at within industries, which companies have pricing power, which companies are doing a really good job of managing their costs and managing to their margins, and which are struggling. I mean, I also like this theme of looking at companies that have very high labor intensity to sales. In other words, do they have to continue to hire, and especially at a time where we know the total cost of an employee continues to rise? Or do they have business models that are scalable? They can continue to grow without adding to additional labor. I mean, we have to live in this environment and invest in this environment. And I think there's some pretty interesting opportunities, even though inflation does pinch our wallets.
Well, okay, give me an example. What sorts of sectors, at least, are you talking about?
Okay, an example might be, like, if you're just thinking in the consumer sectors, for example, you know, some companies have done a really good job of, you know, writing longer-term contracts, of managing their input costs. Sometimes they've made great investments in software and systems and technology so that they've been able to reduce their dependence on labor. All of these things help to sort of mitigate the margin pressure that an inflationary environment might otherwise scare us into, right? And so there are some decent fundamental stories, even in a higher inflationary environment. But you really got to get to know the company.
And there are some beneficiaries of the Fed fighting inflation. Banks, insurance companies, they should benefit from higher interest rates. We think utilities are a really good bond substitute with inflation protection and probably delivering the energy of the future, electrification. And we like healthcare. And healthcare has become the biggest part of consumer spending. It continues to be the fastest growing part. Productivity, medicines, devices are needed there. These productivity providers, we think they're going to be able to play an important role and capture profits. What I love about your clip in 1975 is that even though Paul Volcker recognized the challenge ahead, it surprised even him, the big man, to the upside. Inflation can be a very big problem when that genie's out of the bottle.
Okay, that leads me exactly to my question to you, David, which is you've studied that period.
Yeah.
Do we need this time the sort of medicine that Paul Volcker ended up administering that time? Because it was pretty tough.
It was brutal medicine. And I think people need to appreciate that it was a very high price to pay for allowing inflation to accelerate for so long. Volcker hiked the overnight interest rate to 19% and inflation got to 15%. It caused a recession. But one of the things that's important to recognize is that there was this combination of tightening monetary policy. While there's a lot of pro-supply side policy, it was Reaganomics with Volcker's monetary discipline that really helped seed a terrific 1980s and longer expansion. So we have to just realize that recessions are risky. They could end up becoming nasty. And if things don't go well on the supply side, there could be a recession with inflation still uncomfortably high.
So, Kate, help me here, because you're responsible for making these sorts of decisions. And normally, if you've got a lot of inflation, you don't want to have cash because it's dwindling right, even as you hold on to it. On the other hand, we've got a lot of uncertainty. So what's your approach?
Yeah, you know, normally I would say holding cash in the bank and not investing it or putting it to work in the market in some way, you know, is a waste. And especially in real terms, you just think about that cash kind of burning away. Of course, holding cash in this environment where we've had a really, really challenging period for both bonds and stocks in terms of returns has actually proven to be a really good portfolio diversifier. In fact, we're holding a fairly high level of cash, both as an expression of our duration view. So we've had a sort of shorter duration position in the fund. We also de-risked part of our equity portfolio while still holding some of the higher growth, higher quality companies that I think that can compound over the next couple years. I think you should have dry powder. I really recommend people having some cash at this point. We're going to get some interesting bites at the apple. You know, some other high quality companies, as I was mentioning before, may even get cheaper than this as we, you know, have a very volatile period over the next couple months of policy adjustment and, you know, recession fears fading.
David, in a time of inflation, one thing people tend to go to is real assets, real estate and other kinds of real assets.
Right.
Does that make sense right now?
It does. And there's a nice availability of real assets, and they're investable more than they were back in the past. It's easier to invest in commodities. It's easier to invest in real estate. It's easier to even buy inflation-protected securities. These things, particularly the ease of which they're investable nowadays, I bet you investors wish they had those options in the late 70s and early 80s. So there are ways to help manage through this period of uncertainty and the risks of inflation being high.
Okay, David used the R word, recession. Does an investor need to be taking that into account? And if he or she does, how do they do that?
Look, in these periods of fear in the market, everyone likes to jump onto like a really scary narrative. And right now, everyone's talking about, you know, an imminent recession. That is definitely not our base case at this moment. We think growth is going to decelerate, but we don't see the type of shocks either to the consumer or to the corporate sector or a meaningful pullback in terms of overall fiscal activity that would like launch us into a recession. But I do think we have to think about, you know, where are the areas that we can still see solid growth, less earnings variability in a slower growth environment. And that's where you have to really not just look at history, but look to the future. What are the business models that are very strong? Where is consumption going to continue to be strong? And where are companies spending on each other? An example I might give you is around cloud computing. This is a place that, you know, despite weaknesses in other parts of you know, technology, we continue to see aggressive spend.
Recession risks are a little higher than they normally are at this point in the cycle, so we're on guard against that. But there are worse things that can happen to investors, to long-term investors, than a recession. That's when you get these lost decades. And 1973 to 1982, it's one of the very few periods, 10-year periods, that the equity market had negative real returns, but it did beat bonds over that full 10-year period. Mm. So stay the long-term course. Keep equities and other real assets in the portfolio. And cash is not trash at a time of uncertainty like this. But if you hold on to it for too long, it does rot.
Okay, so this is unfair. There's a curveball, Kate. I'll throw it your way. Cash is not trash. What about crypto? I mean, we've had this whole discussion. There was something like $270 billion worth of value came out of crypto and out of stablecoins. Did that teach us anything in general? I talked to Larry Summers, and he said mainly that greed drives the marketplace.
Yeah, first of all, I'm stealing Dave's cash is not trash, and I might make a like a little tattoo of that on my shoulder. But this is what I'll say. I'm by far and away not an expert or an authority in any on crypto or digital assets. I just would say that for people who are adding that into their portfolios as a diversifier, I think we've seen an incredibly high correlation between all of these assets and actually between a lot of them and, you know, more speculative parts of the technology sector. And, you know, you got to really think about your portfolio construction. This is the very early stages of this, you know, digital finance revolution, if you will. And you have to be, I think, pretty balanced in your portfolio if you're going to own some of those assets.
Such a great.
I don't know where it goes from here, but I will say you have to be cautious.
Yeah. Just quickly, that's such a great point Kate just made. We talk about trying to avoid correlations.
Sure.
So you could be hedged. Mm-hmm. I'm not sure I heard a lot of people talk about the correlation between big tech on the one hand and crypto on the other, but we certainly have seen it recently.
A lot of the same owners. So, yes, they find themselves having been hurt and perhaps having to de-risk. The thing about one of the things to keep in mind, the dollar's been getting stronger. And if the Fed pulls this off well, the dollar will reign supreme again.
What about that, Kate? What about a strong dollar? What does it do to your investment?
Yeah, we take some currency views into consideration. I got to tell you, though, over the course of my career, I don't have the best batting average on making cross currency bets.
Yeah.
You know, what I will tell you, though, is...
Right.
You know, it does affect how we think about our international investment.
Well, I'm sure not a currency trader. So thank you so much. Great to have you both with us. That's Kate Moore of BlackRock and David Bianco of DWS Americas. Coming up, we take a look at what's coming up next week on Wall Street. This is Wall Street Week. I'm David Westin. It's time now to look at what's coming up next week, starting with Juliet Sally in Singapore.
Thanks, David. China will likely report the weakest monthly economic indicators since the outbreak of the pandemic 2 years ago, when April's monthly data dump is released Monday. That is likely to put further pressure on the central bank to boost stimulus to support growth. But economists are still divided as to whether the PBOC will move as early as Monday by cutting the interest rate on one-year policy loans. China's jobless rate, which is forecast to climb again to a two-year high, that will also be in focus after top leaders made an urgent pledge recently to stabilize employment in the face of plunging business confidence. Now over to Laura Reich in London. Laura?
Thanks, Juliet. EU Commission forecasts released on Monday. It's interesting because the last readings were before the war in Ukraine. The expectation this time around is that 1% will be knocked off GDP, while 2% will be added to CPI for 2022. Obviously, this raises the question of stagflation. Both economists and market participants will be listening carefully for any indications of a recession within one of the EU member states. Geopolitics in focus over the weekend with a NATO foreign ministers meeting taking place in Berlin. We will wait to see whether a decision has come from Sweden about joining NATO. Taylor.
Thank you, Laura. Of course, a lot of big economic news coming up next week as well. We're going to be getting a lot of retail sales data on Tuesday, really looking at the health of the consumer in the face of, again, really strong inflation. Then we're also going to get some home market information as well. When you think about rising mortgage rates, again, the highest going back since 2009, up an additional 5.3% here on some of those long-end mortgage rates. So a lot of economic key data here that we're watching in the U.S. David, back to you.
Thanks to Juliet Sally, Laura Wright, and Taylor Riggs. Coming up, the future may look bleak right now, but is it really as bad as some of us make it out to be? And what can we do about it? We talk to a veteran of Wall Street and Washington, Roger Altman of Evercore. That's next on Wall Street Week on Bloomberg.
run-up in stocks and then the subsequent sell-off in stocks on Wall Street is really working its way into the global narrative.
Seeing that sell-off pattern in stocks and bonds really continue.
An economic slowdown spurred another bout of risk aversion.
Here's that rainy day. It's been a long bull run in the markets, in wealth accumulation, and in the economy, which came back fast even after being brought to a halt by a pandemic.
The fact is, America has a lot to be proud of. We're experiencing the strongest economic recovery in the world.
But now, everything that looked so rosy gives cause for concern. From inflation,
look at the numbers, the headline comes in up 0.3%.
To the supply chain,
some of the supply chain headaches that some are saying are reaching an all-time high.
To Ukraine,
the Russians have been acting more like a bulldozer than a Tesla.
To China,
I think they're headed for a growth recession. So yeah, I think the rest of the year is going to be very tough for China.
Leaving an investor to wonder, how bad will it get? And when you ask a question as basic as how bad can it get, you want a true veteran, even a legend of Wall Street and Washington. And that's what we have here in Roger Altman. He is the senior chairman and, of course, the founder of Evercore. Roger, welcome back. It's great to have you here.
Thank you, David. Great to see you.
So it's been a week, maybe a month, of hearing all the bad things everywhere you turn. And it's inflation, and it's the Fed, and it's Ukraine, it's China, it's supply chain. How bad is it?
Well, the S&P 500, as of right now, is down more or less 20%. And that's the definition of a true correction. And so I would say it's been pretty severe. I think the big question is, how much worse can it get? And no one knows the answer to that, and I certainly don't. But it certainly could get worse before it gets better. And, you know, historically, when you see such a profound change in monetary policy, which as we're having now, or in the beginning stages of now. Historically, it's been, at least over the short term after the change starts, bad for equity values. That's really been the case very often. So it's not surprising that stocks are down now that the Fed has ended this relatively long period of almost free money and is headed up on a substantial upward trajectory in terms of tightening. It's not surprising stocks are down, but I think, as you just said, it coincides with a lot of other negative news, most basically inflation, but also some of the other points you make about Ukraine and so forth. And so it could get worse. Do I think we're on the verge of a financial crisis? I don't. I just think it's a sharp correction in equity values, which, when you step back and think about them, in so many cases, especially tech, were hard to rationalize before this changed. I mean, there was some astronomical values, as you well know, and it's not surprising that they're finally being rectified.
So you talk about the equity markets, we can talk about the bond markets as well, which have really taken it on the chin. What is the relationship between those financial markets on one hand and, if I can put it this way, the real world? Because a lot of your work at Evercore is dealing with real companies who are buying and selling companies or pieces of companies. Does it directly translate into the value of those assets, or is it somewhat removed?
It does directly translate in two ways. The stock market is a pretty reliable predictor of the broad economy, albeit 9 months or so in advance of the real economy's changing. So right now, there's a big debate as to whether we may have a recession in 2023. And I think that's about 50-50 myself. But we're slowing down even right now. And the market is, in effect, telling us that. In terms of our own business, oh, yes, it has a big effect, because when the volatility is so high, and the VIX this morning was 32.5, I think, before the day started, people hesitate. They want to step back and wait for the smoke to clear and the environment to settle. And so transactions slow down. There's no doubt about it. And you can see that, by the way, in the valuations of all the investment banks, which have come down a lot for a variety of reasons, but one of them is an anticipated slowdown in transaction volume.
But it's interesting, people start to sit on their hands, if I can put it that way. They're afraid to make a move. And that trumps what otherwise might be an instinct. You know, there are some bargains now. So prices are coming down.
Yes, yes.
The price tag is lower. It might cause some CEOs to say, now's the time to move.
Well, and in fact, just on my way over here, I was on the phone with some of my colleagues because we're having a call tonight with a very, very well-known company that we work with closely. That's a technology company, a very big one. And a lot of the smaller companies they've been interested in buying in recent years have just been too expensive. These aren't tiny companies, but they're smaller than this guy. And we were just observing to ourselves that the valuations have changed so much in the past few weeks that some of these companies they've long studied are now possibly at a level they could buy. So you're right. This environment does create opportunities, but people tend to want to see the smoke to clear or stability to return before they act.
Does it also change the nature of some companies people would be interested in acquiring? In this sense, you referred to the tech sector before. A lot of people say what's going on in tech is basically people have been betting on the come, as it were. It's future earnings. And now they're not as sure, and also as the discount rate goes up, they're not worth quite as much. Does it make more of a premium on companies that are more sort of steady as you go, throw off real cash year in and year out? Does the temperament change?
I think the answer is yes. And to give you a little metric, maybe to support that, in so many areas of technology, the relevant multiple over the last 3 or 4 years has been the multiple of revenue. And so many companies trading at very, very high multiples of revenue. I met with a company this morning, which is private, but its main comparable is public. And the comparable had been trading at, I think, 12 or 14 times revenue until very recently. Those are pretty crazy multiples. Yes, there are examples of transformational technology where occasionally something like that is justified, but that was pretty widespread. And it's changing now. And there was a piece in the New York Times this morning about how unicorns have come down to earth. And there are so many of that, so many cases of that. But the answer is yes.
You said that the stock market is a pretty reliable indicator of potential slowdown in the economy overall.
Or the other way around, when the market begins to rise before the economy does. It can go either way. Right now, the market is projecting a slowdown, but we've also seen plenty of examples where the economy is in bad shape, the market goes up, and the market is telling you that 9 months or 12 months from now, the economy is going to be better.
And the Federal Reserve might well applaud something of a slowdown. I mean, they've got to get inflation under
control.
They said that's their priority.
I mean, they're seeking it, and they're trying to avoid the so-called hard landing, which is a recession. But they're certainly seeking a slowdown in the economy because most recent inflation number 8.5%. That's pretty high.
And so that leads to the question about the soft versus hard landing. A slowdown is one thing, a recession is another. As you look out, what are your expectations about a possible recession? Or maybe as important as you talk to CEOs, you talk to companies, do they have that possibility in mind as they think about possible acquisitions or not?
Well, very few that I would be talking to are yet experiencing a serious slowdown in their own businesses. This is all a question of where will we be in 6 months or so, or later. And I think the big debate in the market is mostly about 2023. Will we see a recession next year? What would cause a recession? It'd be a combination of consumers pulling back, because right now, every single American worker, including you and me, are seeing our real incomes fall, because inflation is running well above the rate of increase in wages, although the rate of increase in wages by historical standards is pretty good. It's running at about 5%, but inflation is running at 8 to 9%. So every single American worker is going backwards right this minute. You do that long enough, a few months, for example, and people start to get conservative, and they start to pull back. That would be one factor. And a second factor would be just the impact of higher interest rates. So mortgage rates, as you know, are up about 250 basis points from their level of 4 or 5 months ago. That's a lot. And that's going to impact the mortgage market and the housing markets. I don't think it's enough to bring them to a halt. But we've been seeing a very hot housing market in this country, both starts and secondary sales. And I think that level of increase in mortgage rates, and there's probably more to come on that, is going to slow down that market. So a combination of interest rates, what I'll call consumer psychology as a place into consumer spending, and maybe business also just in light of the volatility, pulling back a little bit on investment. Those three factors are the what could cause a recession.
Finally, Roger, you've been a leader not just on Wall Street, but also in Washington. Is there anything that President Biden can do about this at this point?
Well, you notice that the last couple of days, really, he's changed his tone on this issue. 2 days ago, he said, this is now my top domestic priority, which is a change of tone. And then yesterday, I noticed on his trip, he was standing in front of a big background, which said, prices down, inflation control. So they've changed their priorities, or at least the way they state them. Actually, I think that's quite good, and it's not trivial, because you want the American public to think that you wake up in the morning with inflation on your mind and you go to sleep with it on your mind, and every single thing you can do, you're going to do it.
Roger, thank you so very much. This is so helpful.
Always a pleasure, David.
That's Roger Altman. He is senior chairman and founder of Evercore. Coming up, we wrap up the week with our special Wall Street Week contributor, Larry Summers of Harvard. This is Wall Street Week on Bloomberg. This is Wall Street Week. I'm David West, and it's time once again this week to have Larry Summers of Harvard come to us and explain this really perplexing week. So, Larry, thanks so much for being back with us. I could call this the week of inflation, as it were, with the CPI numbers, the PPI numbers, something you've been warning about for some time. Now, some people are saying that shows sort of we've hit the peak, it's starting to come down. What did you read into those numbers?
You know, once again, the numbers were worse than people expected them to be. We may have hit a peak last month at 8.5, but we're not headed anywhere near 2 anytime soon. And that says that we've got very big challenges ahead of us in terms of managing this economy. And I think there's a lot of real risks out there. I see an overheated labor market as the core of the inflation process, driving service prices up. And I see lots of risks geopolitically in terms of supply chains, geopolitically in terms of commodity prices. And so I think this is going to be a very difficult environment for quite some time to come.
Well, let's talk about that quite some time to come, because we're now starting to see some people, including Jason Furman on Bloomberg earlier this week, say he thinks that we could have years of inflation. Even if we get a recession, we would, because there are some structural factors that could give us long inflation instead of long COVID.
Look, I think there are two sets of issues that mean that that is a plausible view. One is most inflations don't get stopped with a single slowdown. There are multiple attempts to break inflation before there's ultimate success. That was certainly the case in the previous big inflation that we've had in the modern era in the 1960s and 1970s. And then there's the argument, I'm never sure how much weight to give it, that we're probably in a more labor short economy than we used to be, that the pressures of globalization that we used to feel are no longer there, that there's more capacity of firms to niche market than there used to be, and that all of that means there's going to be a bit less ruthless deflationary pressure than we've seen in most of this century so far, and that that could operate in the direction of higher inflation. I think I'd be very surprised if the average inflation rate during the 2020s wasn't materially higher than the average inflation rate during the decade of the teens. And it's reinforced by a growing number of voices. I'm not yet prepared to join the chorus saying that we should set a target for inflation that is higher than 2%. It could conceivably be ultimately right, but I think moving in that direction immediately would very much undermine what limited anti-inflation credibility the Fed has.
So, Larry, the question then obviously is, what do we do about this inflation? Is there anything that can be done? Obviously, the Federal Reserve has the frontline responsibility, but we also have the executive branch and now the legislature saying, well, we can do some things. We have President Biden saying to the FTC, take a look at price gouging. And then we have the Speaker of the House, Nancy Pelosi, saying she's going to bring legislation forward next week about price gouging at the pump. Is that going to help us?
The price gouging at the pump stuff, the more general price gouging stuff, is to economic science what President Trump's remarks about disinfectant in your veins was to medical science. It is dangerous nonsense. There is no material prospect that in any enduring way gouging legislation can have any substantial effect on inflationary pressure. But it can cause and contrive all kinds of shortages. It can distort a complex network of flows between crude and refined product. It can inhibit the supply responses that are what's ultimately the best way to overcome inflation. This gouging talk is a diversionary confusion. It's something that tends to happen when we have inflations, but we only make progress once we move through that and we understand that the real determinants of inflation have to do with the total level of demand that's being stimulated by policies. If politicians outside the Fed want to make a difference on inflation to the limited extent they can, they should be reducing tariffs, they should be letting more immigrants into the country, they should be reducing regulatory burdens like the Jones Act that mandates that only U.S. ships can take crude oil from Texas to the Northeast. They should be limiting demand by asking borrowers at a moment when they have a better financial condition than any time in a very long time to pay back their student debts rather than maintaining the moratorium. Those are the things that you can usefully do to influence the inflation rate. And all this gouging talk is a pandering diversion from all of that.
So, Larry, let's wrap up this week with a couple of quick rips from the headlines. One of them is cryptocurrencies and stablecoins. The prices of those certainly didn't go up this week. In fact, I saw there was something like $270 billion worth of market value taken away. Do we know anything at the end of the week about cryptocurrency, stablecoin that we didn't know at the beginning of the week?
We've been reminded of something we should have known, which is that fear and greed drive financial markets, all financial markets. And crypto's not immune from that. And bank run phenomena, whether it's banks, whether it's money market funds, whether it's repo or whether it's crypto, when you don't have backing and you lose confidence, you get a big mess.
And finally, Larry, at the very end of the week on Friday, Elon Musk tweeted on the one hand that he was having some second thoughts about Twitter, and then he came back and said, no, he's still committed to it. It's not clear. The stock certainly went down, came back a little bit, but it certainly went down substantially. Does this say something larger about what's going on with tech right now? We saw that the value of so many big tech companies has come down. It's possible this is actually having some buyer's remorse.
Elon Musk is, I think, in some ways the Andrew Carnegie of our time, a titanic, innovative, driving, extraordinarily wealthy figure who, when he has leverage, uses it. And with the changes at Twitter that have already taken place, in the absence of other bidders, he has enormous leverage in this situation. And I suspect he's using it.
It's fascinating. The Andrew Carnegie of our time, that will go down. So, but as a larger issue, is tech not going to have as large a role in the markets going forward as it has in the past?
I suspect the share of total wealth, total stock market that's in tech may be somewhat lower over the next few years than it has been over the last few years. But I think it's going to continue to be the case that the most valuable companies are tech companies. I think it's going to continue to be the case that, as it always is, that technology and the transformations that it brings are driving history. My guess is that we're going to see very profound changes coming out of artificial intelligence over the next decade, and I'm not sure where that's going to go.
Okay, Larry, it's always such a pleasure, a real treat to have you with us. That's Larry Summers of Harvard, a very special contributor for Wall Street Week. Coming up, in a week when everything seemed to be on sale at a discount price, there was one big premium paid for a Hollywood icon, or at least for a version of her. That's next on Wall Street Week on Bloomberg. Finally, one more thought. Amid all the gloom in the markets, a candle in the wind. There's no shortage of pessimism in the markets these days, with central bankers falling over one another to tell us how determined they are to raise rates.
We don't rule out 75 forever, right? I mean, what I'm going to do is I think 50, the cadence we're going now seems about right to me.
And those higher rates can mean only one thing, money coming out of the market and making all those financial assets less valuable than we thought they were.
A trader actually told me that the consensus here is that the S&P 500 will ultimately trade down to a PE multiple of 16 to 18. We're at about 20 to 21 right now. So by that standard, we still have a lot more selling to go.
When it comes to taking money off the table, we always start with the riskier, more speculative parts of our portfolio, like Bitcoin.
Bitcoin, of course, extending losses, even dropping below, well, almost 30,000 at one point on Monday. This is the first time it goes this low since back in July 2021.
And tech stocks, including those in Cathie Wood's ARK fund, which this week gave back all of its gains against the S&P 500, and then some.
Cathie Wood's strategy, for example, of picking stocks that have fallen victim to the tech meltdown. Some of her favorites tumbling in an environment of rising interest rates and high inflation. There's a look at the ARK Innovation ETF.
But fear not, there are some assets that are holding up nicely, even setting new records. Like, for example, 20th Century American Art.
100 million, 110 million, 110 million, 120.
This week, Andy Warhol's portrait of Marilyn Monroe, it's called Shot Sage Blue Marilyn, set a new record going for $195 million. That's almost double the previous record of $110 million for a painting by Jean-Michel Basquiat.
We did sell the most expensive painting of the 20th century. It's the highest price ever paid, close to $200 million. Let it sink in. It's quite something.
So with all the talk about cryptocurrencies and NFTs as the value of the future, it's good to know that the safe haven investment may just be, in the end, good old-fashioned art. Though I'm sure Mr. Warhol would not appreciate being called old-fashioned in any way. That does it for this episode of Wall Street Week. I'm David West, and this is Bloomberg. See you next week.